Cintas performs surface sanitizer and disinfectant spray services to common touch points, installs and refills touchless hand sanitizer dispensers, and provides commercial laundry services to help minimize employee exposure. Give everyone the confidence they need to keep coming back. Visit Cintas.com and get ready for the workday.
I'm Dr. Baker, an ER physician. If you're having leg pain, swelling, or redness, but haven't talked to your doctor yet, don't wait. This could be deep vein thrombosis, a blood clot which could travel to your lungs and lead to a pulmonary embolism, which could cause chest pain or discomfort or difficulty breathing and be deadly. Your symptoms can mean something serious, so don't wait. Talk to a doctor right away, by phone, online, or in person.
Brought to you by Bristol-Myers Squibb and Pfizer.
A county clerk's office in Utah is under quarantine after the staff was exposed to COVID-19, but officials say it won't delay election results. Summit County Clerk Kent Jones says staff was exposed over the weekend. He says the official ballot count will be available on November 17th as planned. Coronavirus cases are on the rise in several states, which could decide the election.
On the eve of Election Day, COVID-19 hospitalizations are up in all 13 states identified as competitive by ABC News that are either leaning Democratic, Republican, or toss-ups, including Pennsylvania, Florida, and Georgia. New cases up in all but two of those battleground states, with New Hampshire the only state where cases are decreasing. And coronavirus deaths on the rise in five of those states: Michigan, Minnesota, North Carolina, Texas, and Wisconsin. Dave Packer, ABC News.
Coronavirus cases are on the rise in New York City, too.
The new reported cases on a seven-day average threshold of 550 cases. Today's report, 593. As I've said before, that is an area of concern. Some of that comes from just a lot more testing, and a lot more testing is a good thing. And I want to keep encouraging people to get tested on a very high level, but we are watching that number carefully.
Mayor Bill de Blasio says one area that's doing well are schools, and that's why he's letting parents opt into in-person learning for their kids if they want. East Coast restaurant chain Friendly's is filing for bankruptcy, the latest in a long list this pandemic. This is ABC News.
Wouldn't it be great if everything came with more? Like if your new computer came with unlimited tech support. When you choose a Medicare plan from UnitedHealthcare, you get more. Like plans that have dental and vision coverage, plus hearing coverage. Call UnitedHealthcare at 1-800-364-1360 to get Medicare with more. Remember, Medicare annual enrollment ends December 7th.
Benefits and availability may vary by plan and location. More plans based on a year-over-year comparison of UnitedHealthcare plans.
Daria Albinger, ABC News.
From the KMET Weather Center for Beaumont, Banning, and the Pass Air. This afternoon, sunshine, a bit of a breeze, a high temperature 86. We'll have a clear sky tonight with lows near 60. For Tuesday, plenty of sunshine, the high 84. For the Inland Empire this afternoon, we'll have sunny skies with temperatures approaching 90. And for Palm Springs, it's going to be sunny. Our high will be 94. I'm meteorologist Jim Rinaldi for Smart Talk 1490 KMET.
Take KMET 1490 AM with you everywhere you go by downloading our free smartphone apps found on the KMET website, KMET1490AM.com. You can also go to the Google Play Store or the Apple App Store on your phone to download the free app. Now you can listen live or play any of your favorite programmers' podcasts using your smartphone. Don't miss out on the free KMET smartphone apps. Go to KMET1490AM.com and download your free phone app today.
The Inner Voice Show is a dialogue between the host and the listeners about their relationships. This show is not an attempt to assess, diagnose, or treat any mental health or illness condition. Please consult your physician, psychiatrist, or psychotherapist for personal matters.
Inner Voice. A Heartfelt Chat with Dr. Foojan.
Hello, everyone. This is the Inner Voice Show, a Heartfelt Chat with me, Foojan. I'm Dr. Foojan Zeine, and with a hello to Sean in the studio and a big hello to all of you. This is a show about what matters most in our life, our minds, our thoughts, feelings, actions, relationships, and our fulfillment in this beautiful journey of life. Today, I will bring you the latest research indicating what's important for all of us for overall happiness as a person uses social media and how that type of using social media can impact a person's overall well-being. I also bring you Christine Arylo. She is a transformational leadership advisor, host of the popular Feminine Power Time podcast, and a three-time bestseller author. Today, we will be talking about her latest book, Overwhelmed and Over It. That's me. Overwhelmed and Over It. I love to hear from all of you, so connect with me through my website, foojan.com, and follow my social media and message me with your comments and topics of interest. I'd love to share whatever you like, right, with guests or for myself, and what I can bring you. I want it to be what you like, so let me know. But first, here's the tip of the week. I've been noticing a lot of tension rising when people are talking to each other or sharing their views in groups, gatherings, or social media, especially this past week, and I'm sure it's going to go on the next week, and probably more. Now, in a day-to-day life, couples and families communicate their differences continuously, and in order to keep their relationships healthy and loving, they have to learn skills to maintain autonomy, take a stand for their needs, while they're flexible enough and respectful enough to take their mate or family member's point of view in consideration, especially if they have to negotiate. When there's a goal to create a cohesive and healthy relationship with our surroundings, then we see them as a part of the larger family and community. When we divide our well-being and interest with others, then we intend to win the argument at any cost, to the detriment of the bigger cause, which is having a healthy family or a community, or even a healthy body or a healthy mental state. You can experience this notion from a small unit of couples and mates to a bigger unit of family, to a larger unit of work and career, community, country, or at best, the whole world, right? It is given that each individual is unique and will always be different from another individual. If we stick to this reality, then we won't hold the fantasy that everyone should have similar views as us. And if we don't stand on a pedestal of righteousness to think that I'm right and I know it all and others are obviously wrong, then I won't enter any dialogue with that notion. More importantly, we would not give ourselves the right to throw our anger and disrespectful words to attack them personally for having their ideas, since in reality, no one has that right. This morning, actually, I went to LinkedIn, and there was this judge who had posted that they decided to do a particular way of sentencing, especially for 18-year-olds and 17-year-olds, and being more flexible and attaching it to them striving versus just being punitive. And I thought it was a great idea, so I just wrote, you know, I'm very impressed with the way you did that. And I figured, oh, I'll put a comment, let me read the other comments. Oh my God, people were swearing, using profanity, putting him down, you are this, you are that. And I'm like, that's unnecessary. Like, you could say your point of view if you don't agree with him. And there were other people who did not agree with him, and they, you know, said it very kindly. But what is it, what happens to us that it's like we think we can? The idea of firing up with anger toward other people's ideas and then attacking them does not lead to any type of healthy relationship, definitely not at home, within our family, at work, or in community, and ultimately does not lead toward our mental and physical health, because the more that we get agitated ourselves and get enraged and start blasting, obviously we fuel the fire. The blast definitely comes back, and we're sitting there all day in our own anger, so I think it's much better if we see what our anger is coming from. And then somebody triggers it like that. So what can you do? When you hear a point of view that just does not appear logical to you and triggers an emotional response for you, ask the other person to repeat what they said. And you can even do this in the social media. And this time, actually listen openly with an intention of receiving the information versus dismissing the information. Repeat to them what you heard and what you understood. Maybe you understood something else. Maybe you understood something that they didn't really mean. And maybe you're getting all pissed off about something that just wasn't even said. Understand the logic behind their point of view. Yeah, everybody, even though it doesn't match your logic, they have their own. It's interesting to know what their logic is. Maybe it'll open our gates of information. Find some similarities between your point of view and theirs. There will always be some similarities that you can find with someone. And ask them if they got it, that you understood their point of view. So if you're repeating what you understood from them, ask them, did I get it right? And if they're like, no, that's not what I meant, I meant something else, then let's find out. What is it that you meant? I prefer for you to get upset or actually see something that is not there versus actually get upset at something that is there versus, you know, being upset at something that is not even there. Ask them to give you an opportunity to share your view and for them to receive it and see the logic behind what you're offering. So if you allow them to see you, if you allow them to hear you in a nice way, they can also now learn from you. Ask them to repeat what they heard from you and understood from you. Thank them for sharing their view and what you have learned and how it enhanced your perspective. If you actually have to negotiate because you need to come to a particular outcome, then first get aligned about the goal and the outcome that you want to create. Then look at the points of differences and begin negotiating toward manifesting the goal that you agreed upon, especially in your community, with your couples or work. Overall, choose respect and acceptance and love through the communication, because if you choose anger and belittling, you're not going to go through the communication. There's just going to be blast. The communication actually stops. Check my book, Life Reset. You can go through the exercises from the awareness integration model. Really get to know yourself and how you can manage your communication and relationships so that you come out shining and happy, and you can handle your, learn how to actually take care of your triggers and things that really trigger you and upset you, because anybody could say anything and it'll just fuel you. If you want to be respected and understood, then respect others and allow for their rights to be, same way you request for your rights to be. And remember, we all live together within our relationships, within our families, communities, cities, countries, and on earth. So let's make it respectfully manageable and peaceful. We'll be right back with the latest research.
Hello, listeners, this is Christopher from The Christopher Show. Hey, if you missed one of our shows here at KMET, don't worry about it. You can go to our webpage, and that's KMET1490AM.com. Go to the homepage, click on the SoundCloud tab, and hear any show anytime you want.
Join the conversation every Monday afternoon at 3 p.m. Pacific for Inner Voice Heartfelt Chat with Dr. Foojan. Dr. Foojan is a radio and TV host, international speaker, psychotherapist, life coach, and the author of Life Reset, The Awareness Path to Create the Life You Want. She brings you the latest research and interviews with experts in the field of cognitive sciences. Anyone who loves to grow and create growth for humanity gets a voice on this call-in show. Inner Voice Heartfelt Chat with Dr. Foojan. Monday afternoons at 3 p.m. Pacific on Smart Talk KMET 1490 AM and on KMET1490AM.com.
Here's the latest research from University of British Columbia, indicating what's most important for overall happiness is how a person uses social media. Researchers took a close look at how people use three major social platforms, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and how that use can impact a person's overall well-being. Social network sites are an integral part of everyday life for many people around the world,
Every day, billions of people interact with social media. Yet, the widespread use of social network sites stands in sharp contrast to the comparatively small body of research on how this use impacts a person's happiness. Even before COVID-19 and self-isolation became standard practice, social media had transformed how we interact with others. Face-to-face, in-person contact is now matched or exceeded by online social interactions as the primary way for people to connect. While most people gain happiness from interacting with other face-to-face, some people actually come away from using social media with a feeling of negativity for a variety of different reasons. One issue is a social comparison. Participants in this study said the more they compare themselves to others while using social media, the less happy they felt. Viewing images and updates that selectively portray only others positively may lead social media users to underestimate how much others actually experience negative emotions and lead people to conclude that their own life with all of its mixed of positive and negative feelings is by comparison not really as good. Researchers note that viewing other people's posts and images while not interacting with them lends itself to comparison without the mood boosting benefits that ordinarily follow social contact, undermining well-being and reducing self-esteem. Passive use of just scrolling through others' posts and updates involves little person-to-person reciprocal interaction while providing ample opportunity for upward comparison. As part of this research, study participants were asked about four specific functions of Facebook: checking in news feedback, messaging, catching up on the world news, and posting status or picture updates. The most frequently used function was just kind of like passively checking one's newsfeed. Participants primarily used Facebook without directly connecting with other users, and the negative effects on subjective well-being were consistent with this form of use. So during COVID-19, people naturally turn to social media to reduce feelings of social isolation. Yet, although people use social media more when they were lonely, time spent on social media only increased feelings of loneliness for participants in the study. Today, the necessity of seeing and hearing friends and family only through social media due to COVID-19 might serve as a reminder of missed opportunities to spend time together. The more people used any of these three social media sites, the more negative they reported feeling afterwards. The study also included offline interactions with others, either face-to-face or on a phone call, comparing both offline communication with online, was able to demonstrate that offline social interactions had precisely opposite effects of using social media, strongly enhancing emotional well-being. But all is not lost, as these researchers also reveal how people can use social media positively, something more important than ever during this time of pandemic. Researchers suggest people avoid passively scrolling and resisting comparing themselves to other social media users. They also said people should use social media sites to enable direct interaction and social connection, maybe writing a note for them and getting into conversations that would boost you, actually, even if you're doing it on the internet or the social media. For example, talking online with arranging time spent with other in person when possible with proper cautions, also, you know, putting a mask and all of that actually works. If we all remember to do that, the negative impact of social media use could be reduced, and social network sites could even have the potential to improve our well-being and happiness. In other words, we need to remember how we use social media and has the potential to shape the effect of our day-to-day happiness. We'll be right back with Christine Arylo. Thank you.
Take KMET 1490 AM with you everywhere you go by downloading our free smartphone apps found on the KMET website, KMET1490AM.com. You can also go to the Google Play Store or the Apple App Store on your phone to download the free app. Now you can listen live or play any of your favorite programmers' podcasts using your smartphone. Go to KMET1490AM.com and download your free phone app today.
Hello, listeners. This is Christopher from The Christopher Show. Hey, if you missed one of our shows here at KMET, don't worry about it. You can go to our webpage, and that's KMET1490AM.com. Go to the homepage, click on the SoundCloud tab, and hear any show anytime you want.
Join the conversation every Monday afternoon at 3 p.m. Pacific for Inner Voice Heartfelt Chat with Dr. Foojan. Dr. Foojan is a radio and TV host, international speaker, psychotherapist, life coach, and the author of Life Reset, The Awareness Path to Create the Life You Want. She brings you the latest research and interviews with experts in the field of cognitive sciences. Anyone who loves to grow and create growth for humanity gets a voice on this call-in show. Inner Voice Heartfelt Chat with Dr. Foojan. Monday afternoons at 3 p.m. Pacific on Smart Talk KMET 1490 AM and on KMET1490AM.com.
Have you ever wished you could just wake up one day, reach across your nightstand, and hit the life reset button? Let's face it, the struggles and frustrations of everyday life leave millions of women and men around the globe yearning for a new way. And the new way is right here in Life Reset, the awareness integration path to create the life you want by Dr. Foojan Zeine. You can get it now at Foojan.com or Amazon.com. Life Reset, the awareness integration path to create the life you want. You deserve it.
Well, welcome back, everyone. I'm Dr. Foojan Zeine, and I'm so excited to have Christine Arylo with me. She's the author of Overwhelmed and Over It. That's me, Overwhelmed and Over It. So we're going to definitely talk about that, which I'm just going to get all that I can from her because I am overwhelmed and over it. She's a transformational leadership advisor, three-time best-selling author, and the host of popular Feminine Power Time, Feminine Power Time podcast. She's recognized worldwide for her work helping women to make shift happen in the lives they lead, the work they do, and the world they wish to create. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Foojan, and thank you, everyone. So good to be here. I'm excited to dive into this with you all today.
Yes. So you say it's not your fault. You feel so stressed and overwhelmed that the system you work and live in were built for a burnout. And however, you are the only one that you could change all of it. And I know that I personally have this dilemma, Christine, that I overwork myself and I love what I do. I get very excited and I'm like, let's do this one. Now let's do this project. And then when I don't do it, it feels like, okay, now what do? I get bored. Am I significant? Am I not? And then there's also, you know, the anxiety of obviously I've got to work in order to sustain my life and all of it. And I see that all with a lot of my clients also. So we work, you know, we have what we have to do, which is work for the financial concept. And then there's this meaning of success that, you know, I've got to be somebody and am I significant or not? Am I making a difference or not? And then, you know, all the other roles that come up also for women, being successful businesswoman or career woman, and then mother, and then family person, and then a wife, and just on and on and on and on. And I think that's become part of what we know, and yet it doesn't work for us. Mm-hmm. Tell us.
That's true. Well, this is what set me on a journey about a decade ago, mm-hmm. of why is it that we've been told we can do and be anything, And we've been, you know, self-esteem and self-empowerment and like all of this, which is all good. But like you said, I mean, pretty much every woman I know is tired. We're tired. And you know, I think if we're honest, we're kind of sick and tired of trying to do and be and have it all. And I just realized this was about a deck because I had the same thing. I mean, basically about 10 years ago, I found myself in the throes of what I called a superwoman sob. And perhaps you've had these, Foojan, if when the pressure is too much, and even for a strong woman, we just, the tears come, and then usually followed by some despair and then thoughts of like, maybe I could just move to a different country and, you know, or downsize my life. And then we get, oh gosh, like I can't actually do that. I mean, I have to just, you know, go back in. So we take a breath and we go back in. And this has been happening for like decades, actually hundreds of years. And it's just gotten significantly worse in the last 60 years or so since women went fully into the workforce. And so it brought me to this question of like, what's going on? Like we have stress management, you know, manage your stress and self-care and like all of these strategies, but it's not working. It's not working. And that led me to go back and actually have some deep conversations with the women who were kind of at the forefront of the last rise of the feminist movement, and including Gloria Steinem. I was able to have a one-on-one conversation with her. And what I learned, the same thing they all said, is that what happened back then, like the late 70s, early 80s, was, yeah, basically said, women, okay, you can have more. Do what you want to do, like go out there, build these, you know, lives, be successful in the careers. But we're not going to take anything away. And we're not going to change the systems to actually support what it looks like to be a woman who's fully expressed in her work, is fully expressed as her mother herself, is fully taking care of herself. And until the systems change, we're just going to keep doing more. So that's what we've been doing. And it's kind of like the best metaphor I have is it's like treading water. And we've all been treading water, kind of just keeping our heads above the water. And then what happened in this year, I call it the great catalyst of 2020, what's happened is like, whoosh, like a deluge of water. And now like, we're like all like underwater, and then we kept our head up. Like there's, you can't put any more. There's no room. There's no room for any more. And so I feel like that's the call of this book. It's interesting. I've been writing it for 3 years that it would come out now, that Overwhelmed and Over It would come out. Like literally on the, I'm looking at the cover, it has a line under Over It. Mm-hmm. And that is really where I'm inviting all of us women to be like, this way is not working. We're not just going to keep band-aiding it. We actually have to get to the root underneath why this is happening and then embrace our power to actually do things differently.
And you say stop tolerating it as a normal construct and stop to the cure the symptom and start putting wellness and sustainability and real wealth at the core of what you want. Your book really creates a system as someone reads it and goes through and even can work it through as an exercise. So you talk about liberating your success and instead of wanting everything that's out there to have it all, do it all, be it all, to really kind of like focus and embrace what it is that it's you and it's right for you and what it, you know, which type of success calls you. And I do think that this concept of being a superwoman out there and then the construct of social media and everybody putting, you know, their best out there, there's this concept of everybody's success is out there, so I need to be as if like everybody else's success. Mm-hmm. And then doing that type of a superwoman. And if I'm not, and I really see this with women, that if I'm not the best career person, the best entrepreneur, the richest, the most wonderful wife and most wonderful mother and the community worker and this and that, then somehow I'm failing. It's no longer that I can be successful at one thing, but if I'm not successful at all, that somehow I'm failing. Share with us what your thoughts are in the book.
So happy we're having this conversation, you all, today. This is exactly why I wrote this book. I'm like, we need to drop these facades that we somehow have it all together, because that's part of the disservice we're doing to each other as women. And it's something I struggle with this, even being part of social media. I actually took a year off of social media while I wrote the book, because I'm like, I just can't even deal with that consciousness over there. I just need to get this wisdom into the hands of women. And I think if we were all really honest, and this is what I feel like the conversations we're having right now, is that, you know, I've talked to so many women, and this has been me myself as well, who we create our own jail cells. We create our own unsustainable realities. And women that you would think like, wow, she does have it all. Like, she's successful in this way and this way and that way, and all that comparison, you know, that we do. And these women that you would say like, she has it all, she's figured it out. So many of them, I have some superpower where women drop off the side. Maybe this happens for you too in your practice. Will call me on the phone or be in a session with me, and they say things to me like, if I keep working this way, I'm going to die. If I keep working this way, I'm going to get sick. I can't keep doing it. I can't keep doing it. And what I want to say to everybody, this has full body chills right now, is that when that voice speaks, that is your feminine wisdom. And she is like, wake up and pay attention. And what's been happening is, because of all this outside stuff and these like, and not even not having the tools. I mean, that's the other thing I just want to underline, is that these tools that we've been given, these strategies for self-care and stress management and time management, they're really meant to help women be more like machines than human beings. How much can I produce and how many people can I take care of? And it's not actually how we work best as women. And so I think we have to, I call it the no more line. There's this moment you come to in your life, and this is what I'm inviting all of us as women right now to do at this time, to look around our lives and say, what is no longer sustainable?
Yes.
Where, what is no longer sustainable in how you're working, in how you're relating, and how you've set up your life design? Because that pressure, that overwhelm, that non-sustainability is a sign that something's out of alignment.
Yes.
And that's where you have to be able then to slow down and start to go inside and hear, which is scary pants, because then you have to look at all the ways you've constructed a reality based on your own fear, lack of worth, you know, distorted value system, you know, et cetera. But that's where the liberation actually is at.
I remember, you know, having this conversation with myself right before the COVID hit. And then, when it hit, obviously, because of being a therapist and everybody going through a lot of depression, uncertainty, my practice went over the roof, and the request for people, for me to be in other shows and media and constantly talking, it went over the roof. So suddenly I found myself 10 months of not going on vacation, not doing anything except working with my clients and being producing media. And like last week or so, when I went and did some of my work, and I found, you know, the cyst in my breast, in my uterus, and suddenly was like, I knew it. I know that when I'm not getting nurturing back, mm-hmm. Something happens to my body. And I just realized, like, in 1 year, most of it is 10 pounds, this 10 months that I gained like 16 pounds of just sitting and working and not taking care of any other area of my life. And it was like, you know, the brick hit is like, women, you're not taking care of your body. Guess what happens? Your body's saying, And it's, and then what's funny, Christine, is I do know these things. And then every morning when I wake up, I've set up the life which I effortlessly walk into the same thing that I've created and not realize that I got to create something else. Mm-hmm. Because in the morning when I wake up, it's easier because my calendar is set up the same way. I haven't changed the calendar for it to call me to do something else. And one of the great things that you have in your book is it's balancing and embracing and cultivating harmony. And you also put in this harmony wheel, which is knock, knock, you got other aspects of life, like all of this got to be balanced. And if it's not, you're going to go down and you're not going to be able to do any of what you think you're going to be able to do.
Yeah, it was when I just got full body chills. Just that, like, that part where we think we're indestructible and invincible. And in the middle of the middle section in the book is called Liberate Your Heart. And in that, there's a story of a woman named Akalia, who was my first client. So I do leadership mentorship with work with women. And she died. My first client to ever die. My first, you know, client's a weird word, but it's not like that. It's like, you know, my woman who was my student and my friend, she beat cancer twice. And passionate, like just like us, like passionate, wanted to change, you know, be part of changing the world, thought the way that the corporate world worked was not really supportive of humans. and she had that voice that said, if you don't get off the road, she was in pharmaceutical sales, you're going to die. Like, this was the voice. So we did a lot of deep heart work with her to get those, what I call the inner mean girls, out of her head, so she could understand where those deeper parts were coming from, where she gave to everybody else. And she's on the board of this and the board of that, and, you know, stretched too thin. And she did get off the road and for a couple of years, and she got to do mentoring, and it was lovely. And then financial stuff showed up, and there was an imbalance in her relationship with her partner. And she was the major breadwinner, had always been. She was going to take another big pharma job and have 17 direct reports and go back on the road. And she texted me from Dallas saying, you know, I'm already feeling the angst, but I have to take the job. That's how she felt. And 3 weeks later, 3 days after Christmas, she was dead. And I feel like I dedicated the book to her too. And I appreciate you bringing that up, because what we're talking about is not self-care. Mm-hmm. What we're talking about is your life. What we're talking about is our sustainability as a woman, as a person. What we're talking about is what we're handing down to our children. When you have 8-year-old girls coming home and asking their mothers if they can be on anti-anxiety medication, we have a situation, you all. You know, when you have the number of meltdowns that I hear from mothers about their freshman daughters who go into college and they break down and they can't handle the pressure because they've been so pressurized in high school. By the time they get there, they just, like, this is serious. And I think it gets floo-flooed and foo-fooed with the whole self-care stuff out there, right? And so I appreciate you bringing this in, because there's this bigger conversation we need to have as women and beings of, like, this isn't working, we have to do something. And then people go, oh my God, I don't even know how to solve that. Like, I can't, I'm tired. And so I also want to say to everybody right now where we're at, it's been a year. And I'm tired. I mean, honestly, you all, today, you know, we're taping this on a Monday, and I had a retreat on Saturday. I had a women's leadership circle on Sunday. And normally this is my space day after I do a retreat. And there hasn't been a lot of space days because of the intensity. But I also want to make it practical for everybody. And so there's this part where we're at right now at the end of the year. This is the time to actually make a shift. And in the rhythm of how you've been living, you can't just keep pushing through to the end of the year and then into January. And so, like, this morning, I actually, even though I, you know, we're doing this taping today and I have a meeting later with my team, I did take 2 hours and I did Abhyanga massage, and I'm doing some other stuff. Literally, like, well, I'll just be honest with you. I did a yoni steam, which I had never done before, you know. And I'm like, whoa, you know. But I've been doing a lot of abdominal massage work and stuff, because in my body, that's where it shows up too. It shows up with fibroids, and I'm like, I'm keeping my lady parts. I'm not letting them go. Like, so what do I got to do to, like, get this body into balance? Because I'm keeping all the parts. Like, that's, you know, really clear. And so it's like that part of, like, it's like not normal just for these things to be happening. And so it's like that part, I'm like, oh, okay, yeah, I've been getting so much this year just to keep people stabilized, but I need to receive a lot more than I have, and I need to restructure. And that's one of the practices is actually following the natural cycles of the year. So pausing at the equinoxes, pausing at the solstices, pausing at what are called the cross quarter turns. There's 8 different times that the energy shifts, and it gives you this opportunity to be like, oh, it's time for, I need to reset my patterns. And at the end of the year, I always say to people, you know, like 2 months before we end, how do you want to walk through the rest of this year? What do you need to nurture yourself to be sustained so that you don't wait till December 28th to take a breath, but you start to actually make the shifts now that you need to sustain you?
Yes, and you brought 8 kinds of burnout. And I think it's important for us to talk about, because most of the time when people think about burnout, they only think about work burnout. But we also have to realize that most of the women who are mothers, the past 10 months and maybe more, have to actually now be teachers at home. They've had to work at home. They've had to do everything at home and to carry it all. And you could really sense burnout from people. And even if they've had to be the caretakers of even their elderly parents because they needed extra taking care of through the COVID. So you talked about the burnout of mental, emotional, compassion. And this is for a lot of nurses or for us therapists or doctors, and that they're burnout of compassion in a sense, or relational or survival, the superwoman syndrome. Talk about passion burnout and a physical burnout, which if we're not really realizing that it could happen in any of the levels, that it still hits us. It might start from one area, but it kind of moves to all the other areas because that's what burnout does. And to kind of bring it back into a system in that you bring back your life force. Talk a bit about how to cultivate that type of a life force on a daily level.
So what you're talking about is really important. And so my traditional training was in the corporate MBA world, business entrepreneurial eventually. And then I got that I had tools to assimilate and basically survive. I didn't really have the tools to thrive, even though everyone's walking around, thrive, thrive, thrive. I'm like, great, yeah, we all know, need more sleep, eat your green vegetables, but we actually really don't have the wisdom. And that led me to go deep into what's called the wisdom tradition. So I've studied deeply indigenous wisdom. I've studied deeply feminine wisdom and deep yogic wisdom and yogic science. And they all say the same thing, that burnout and disease, the last place it shows up in your body is in the physical body. It's actually been in your emotional field, your energetic field, your psychic field, your all these different fields. I mean, the yogic science, they teach you have 10 different bodies. Most of us are hardly even connected to our physical body, right? But then it's like we wait till that physical symptom shows up. And one of the patterns that I uncovered in my 10 years of research, because I had this. So basically what I was able to do is find these 12 imprints that are not just beliefs, but they're mental, they're emotional, they're spiritual, they're psychic, they're cellular, that cause us to sacrifice ourselves and make choices. So it's really all about choices that create this depletion and burnout and overwhelm and self-sacrifice. And one of them is how we give, almost like the metaphor I have is like banks that give all these withdrawals. So you're giving and not receiving. And you don't realize it. So there's this, I don't know if you've ever had this experience, Fuja, of we wait till we get sick. We drain, deplete, get sick, burn out, then refill. You know, it's like we have to wait for the disaster or the drama or the disease. And then we're like, I should pay attention. And in life force is one of those things that, you go back to Ayurveda and Chinese medicine, like the Egyptians, like we've been talking about life force forever. It's only in this crazy Western civilization where people are like productivity machines that we're like, oh, life force, kind of weird, kind of woo-hoo. You know, it's like, no, like that's your energy, that's your juice. And so one of the things that I, can I teach you all, can I share one of my top 3 practices that have kept me out of burnout? So one of the things, my hope is for everyone to bring more awareness to your own burnout cycle and what that burnout cycle is. And so like mine was like every 3 months I suffer a lot from passion burnout because like you, which I like, I'm just like when I create and do. And then all of a sudden I like wake up one morning, I look at my hand and I'm like, I have a body. I have needs. What? So I started working with an acupuncturist and he caught on to my burnout cycle. It took him about a year, year and a half. And so I would go in every 3 months, exhausted, depleted, on the verge of getting sick or maybe even sick. And he would put needles in me, give me herbs, send me home. A year and a half goes this of his observing me. One day I go in completely drained and he puts no needles in. He just puts his hands on my belly and he says these words that I'm going to give to you all right now, hopefully to imprint and remember, which was the word retain. And he just repeated that, retain, retain, retain. And I was like a little retain, you know, just give, drain, drain, drain. And then like fill up, like retain your life force. Just like you think of saving money, right? It's like you want to retain your life force so you're not going into those deeper reserves. And so this practice, so that caused me to create this practice, which I do every morning, and I've done every morning since 2012. And I will honestly say this is one of the top three that has, I haven't burned out since. I've stepped on the line, put a foot over the line, but I catch myself. So can I lead us through it?
Would that please be okay? Yes, yes.
Okay, so you're going to do it. I'm going to do it. And everybody who's here with us, do it too. So I want you to close your eyes and just take a deep inhale, just to bring all of your energy into yourself. Sometimes I like to just imagine kind of rooting down into the ground like a tree. And then take one hand and put it on your heart that connects you to your emotions and your emotional needs. And then put one hand on your belly, which really just connects you to your physical needs, your life force, your creativity. And then just imagine that your body is like a chalice. And when you are full of vitality and life force, this chalice is full. Or you can even imagine if it helps you to kind of feel like a battery where you have an energy charge. So we're going to ask your inner wisdom right now, what is your life force level right now? On a scale of 0 to 100, kind of imagining like you see yourself as a chalice, kind of like, you know, sensing in, sticking a dipstick in there, a sensor to see how full, on a scale of 0 to 100, with 100 being completely charged, completely full, 50 being at half charge or half full, and 0 being completely empty.
Minus 50.
Yeah, I'm a 63. So I'll share the scale here in a moment. So the next one is to question is, what do you need to receive today? What do you need to receive so that you can fill up on that life force, whether it's emotional or physical or mental, spiritual? What do you need to receive today?
For me, it's like the love and connection.
Yeah, I heard just like my inner wisdom is screaming at me, space, space, you need space. Okay, so go ahead and open your eyes. So you're 50 and you need love and connection. I am a 63 and I apparently need space. So here's the thing. This is about giving and receiving. The old imprint is it's better to give than receive. So we bankrupt ourselves. The new imprint is it's better to give and receive. And you want to check in every day because you don't wait till your cell phone battery, right, is dead. Well, I mean, sometimes I do. I'm always like, this battery is always an indicator oftentimes of my battery, you know, when it's always running down to 0. And so if you're 75 and above and you don't give, you don't receive that day, you're not going to go into what we call serving from your reserves. The serving from your reserves is if you're a 50 or below. And that's when the physical disease and the mental, you know, anxiety and the emotional distress start to set in. Between 50 and 75, you still need to receive so that you don't go below that 50. If you're a 50 or like up to like a 25, you need to change how you're giving that day. You need to shift it because you actually are in the like that depletion zone. So you might let go of meetings, you ask for more support, I dress differently on, you know, on those days. And if you're below a 35, like I would say, you need to like, you are in self-sustainability danger zone. You need to create some serious space, a couple days, and really reset. The lowest I've gotten since I've been doing this is a 43. And that day, I couldn't do it that day, but that weekend I cleared complete space and I did not deal with the outside world at all. And I only did things that nourished me. And then got clear on why I had gotten to that space. And if you do this every day, what you'll now you have to design your day. So you need to make sure that you design your day to get love and connection. Mm-hmm. I need to I'm like, space, wow, yeah, I got stuff happening today. Am I going to really show up? And am I going to do that for myself? And that's where that fierce self-love comes in, and that fierceness of not taking care of yourself, but caring for yourself. So I like to take that word taking care of, because it feels like, oh God, I have another person to take care of, to care for yourself. And then when it shows up, you receive it. And that's how it works. I do this every morning. My partner and I do it together as a way to connect. So we ask each other that question. And then I do it in the evening as part of my downshifting practice, so I can design my evening in a way that actually I receive what I need.
Beautiful. In 1 minute, is there anything that we haven't touched and talked about and you really, really want our audience to know?
I think I would just go back to where we started of, it's not your fault, and you are the only one with the power to change it. And they're just things you don't know. I mean, there are literally things you do not know, and about yourself and your own imprints and about how you've been trained to work and the beliefs that we have about how it has to be done. So it's really, this is an invitation into a deeper wisdom within yourself and also within these deep wisdom traditions that we can apply to modern times. It's very practical. And it will also bring you deeper into yourself, which there's nothing to be afraid of. It's just you in there.
True. Absolutely true.
Right?
Tell us a little bit about your podcast, Feminine Power Time.
Yeah, I started Feminine Power Time, Turn Off the Chat or Tune Into What Matters, about 4.5 years ago, because I felt like we needed to have a place to have deeper, meaningful conversation and a space that people could come to turn off the outside world, to tune into this world, and to also take those deep wisdom traditions and make them practical. And I love it. I mean, I love having this conversation with you. I think it's a place, I was a vlogger for a long time. I still have a YouTube channel, but I felt like, I'm like, you know what? I can't help you in 6 minutes. I can just give you a little thing that'll keep you floating. I don't want to just give you a little tidbit to keep you floating. Like, I want to take you where the real change and transformation can go. Mm-hmm. And so it's my love. It's my joy. I love it. And it's the great way to stay connected to me is through Feminine Power Time.
Beautiful. So everyone, Christine Arylo, she's the author of Overwhelmed and Over It. It is a wonderful book. I really suggest for all of you to get it. You can go to christineorylo.com, and also go to the podcast, Feminine Power Time. Thank you so much, Christine, for being with us and sharing your wisdom with all of us.
Thank you very much.
And for all of you who are out there, create an amazing world for yourself and everyone around you. And until next week, bye-bye.
The Inner Voice Show is a dialogue.